Joel.
How many people finish work and have 20,000 people stand up and give him a hand? People in an audience want to get loose. They want to feel great.
A living legend who had to battle for his success.
He was a boxer. He brought a lot of that pugnaciousness to the stage with him.
He's fought for his sound.
He took the album when he played it for the first time and flung it against the wall.
He's taken on record executives.
Billy appeared to be this unmanageable artist.
He struggled with personal demons.
I didn't even realize it was a suicide note until I got a call to say Billy was in a coma.
Failing relationships. Devastating financial blows. And despite 5 decades worth of knockdowns, he always seems willing to re-enter the ring.
Don't take any from anybody.
By 1987, 38-year-old Billy Joel had already won audiences over in live concerts throughout the free world.
Too late to change. You may be wrong, but all I know, you may be right.
And he was about to make history by performing behind the Iron Curtain.
I mean, this is the first time an American pop star ever came over.
He was very much an emissary of American culture. He went over there as a representative of the U.S., so it meant a lot to him.
I've never seen him feel so tensed up, and, you know, it was almost like he was carrying the Cold War on his shoulders.
Just because I'm a musician, that doesn't mean I can tell people how to think or what to do. In a situation like this, to spout a lot of politics would be counterproductive. They've heard it, we've heard it. What they haven't heard is the music.
Russian audiences are not used to going wild for rock stars. They're used to being policed very carefully and being told not to, you know, scream and clap.
Billy wanted the Russian audience to have the same kind of rock and roll experience American audiences enjoyed.
I like song Billy Joel.
The fans were pumped, and so was Billy. But then, showtime.
They were filming it, and they put the lights out onto the audience.
We were making a live concert special, and so the audience was lit up.
Stop lighting the audience!
And it pissed him off, because this audience has fought to be here, and here they're all lit up. They're on camera.
Let me do my show, for Christ's sake!
And he felt that they were being cheated.
He had a bit of a fit on stage because they kept turning up the lights and the people would get intimidated.
He was kind of letting the lighting guy know, bring the lights down. And nobody was really listening to him or got the message, so he had to be a little dramatic.
And he took his electric piano and tossed it off the stage, which I thought, okay, this could be trouble.
Not only did Billy give the Soviets a taste of American rock and roll, he gave them a taste of his Long Island fighting spirit. Billy Joel was born May 9, 1949, to European Jewish immigrants Rosalind and Howard Joel. The couple raised him and his older sister Judith in the sprawling tract housing development of Levittown in Hicksville, New York.
While his father was still living in Levittown with the family, he discovered that Billy had an aptitude at an early age for the piano. Billy Joel's father was a piano child prodigy himself.
Billy would sit down, he'd like make rainstorms, favorite thing. You hit the bass notes and it like sounds like thunder, and you hit the top notes, it sounds like rain falling. And so, you know, you'd get Little Billy's storm song. Eventually, his mom and dad said, if he's going to play it, let him play it right. And so at about 4 years old, they started hauling him off to piano lessons.
Billy's father being born in Europe and being very much a part of that classical music. I think that they had a musical connection when Howard was around back in Hicksville.
Unfortunately, this musical bond between father and son would soon be broken.
Howard just was not happy in America. Europe was what he remembered. Europe was what he loved. He felt that, you know, Germany was a cultured country compared to America.
So it just reached a point where his father decided that he'd had enough of America.
And so he left. And he left his wife and two children behind. I don't even know if he gave her the choice of moving to Vienna with him.
I was not quite 10 years old. We ended up being the only family of a divorce in our neighborhood. And there was sort of a stigma to that at the time.
After Howard's exit, Billy's mother squirreled away enough money to continue with Billy's lessons.
There was a woman in the vicinity who had a ballet school and also taught piano lessons. So he would go over to her place to study the piano.
I had to walk down the street with the piano books under my arms. In my neighborhood, they would beat you up. It's, where you going? Were you going to take ballet? Where's your tutu?
Billy fought back against the bullying by running with a tough crowd.
He would go upstairs at night, say, "Night, Mom!" And he would jump out the window and go out where the Parkway Green Gang met, and they would smoke cigarettes, drink cheap wine, kick over trash cans, and whistle at the girls and stuff.
Just a lot of strutting around and acting tough, which is something Billy would be doing for pretty much the rest of his life, or at least for a lot of his adulthood.
Something else Billy did to help him hold his own in Hicksville: boxing.
He once said that because his father had left, he had to learn his masculinity by boxing. That was how he kind of came of age.
I boxed amateur. It was a police boys club. We'd have intramurals with the Golden Gloves guys. But I got punched around pretty good. I had about 26 fights.
He went 22-4. 2, he lost by decision. And 2, he lost by knockout, including his last fight.
Though Billy's hobby was boxing, his true passion remained music. But not the music of his father's generation.
Beatles came along when Billy was 14. So he was the perfect age to be caught up in that excitement.
These were four scruffy lads from some working class town, just like my friends and I. And I said, this is possible, this can be done. That's what I want to do. I want to do what they do.
Billy was just 15 years old when he and some friends formed their first rock and roll band.
My first gig, I was up on stage, and all of a sudden these women are looking at me, these girls. And I'm thinking, hey, this is not bad. And at the end of the night, we were playing at some church somewhere. The priest comes over and he gives us $5 a piece. So that was it, I was hooked.
The young Beatles-inspired cover band, which at the time went by the name The Lost Souls, began competing in Battle of the Band competitions.
They were one of the Long Island representatives at the New York State Battle of the Bands at the New York World's Fair. So, you know, they were probably pretty good.
In search of more gigs, the Lost Souls auditioned for Irwin Mazur, whose father owned the popular Long Island nightclub, My House.
It was a very popular place. It was in a strip mall, of all things.
At the time, Mazur was looking for a keyboardist to round out a more established Long Island band he managed, called the Hassles.
This little guy playing a small portable organ comes in, and there was something about his playing and there was something about his voice that really got my attention.
He understood all the mechanics of the piano. He was a very good keyboard player, and he also had a decent voice.
So I approached this young man, who I think was 16 at the time, going to Hicksville High School, and I persuaded him to join the Hassles as the keyboard player.
Billy joined forces with Howie Blavel on bass, Richard McKenner on guitar, John Small on drums, and Edward Little Ed Dizik on tambourine and vocals as the new and improved Hassles.
At this point, Billy's gigging 3-4 nights a week and not getting a lot of sleep, and he's waking up late, and he's getting to class late, and he's truant, and he's having all sorts of, you know, problems like that.
I went all the way through 12th grade, but I just hadn't showed up for school half the time. So at the end, they said, well, we can't graduate you because you haven't showed up, so you have to go to summer school. So I went, I'm not going to Columbia University. I'm going to Columbia Records.
In 1968, Billy Joel was an 18-year-old high school dropout with no job. His only career option was music. And at the time, he had all his eggs in one basket, a Long Island rock band called the Hassles.
I met Billy when we were 19, and he was in the Hassles. He was already a little bit of a star. He was like, oh man, keep your eye on this one.
Though the Hassles' energy as a live act generated buzz among local fans, their popularity at teen clubs didn't translate into album sales.
The Hassles didn't really have hits. You have to be open to new markets. That's how you build an audience. The Hassles sort of imploded after two albums.
Unable to build a fan base outside of Long Island, the Hassles split up.
After the Hassles broke up, Billy decided that they should do a two-man supergroup.
Billy and John Small, the drummer from the Hassles, wanted to make a heavier group.
A heavy metal organ duo, basically, with Billy on organ, John on drums.
It was Billy and John wanting to be Led Zeppelin. You know, they wanted to be the loudest two-piece band on the planet.
And they called themselves Attila.
I couldn't imagine where his imagination was going, but I had my confidence in Billy.
Mazur became Attila's manager, and while Billy and John Small collaborated, Billy began sharing rent at the so-called Rock House, where John lived with his wife, Elizabeth.
Elizabeth is a very sharp, very smart, very directed woman. She knows what she needs in a relationship, and John was not giving that to her at the time.
Elizabeth often confided in Billy about her marital frustrations. And as her relationship with John began to crumble, a secret bond with Billy began to take shape.
Billy and Elizabeth started having an affair.
As time went on, his feelings and his heart and his soul was caught up into this relationship and this torrid love affair that they were having.
Billy had tremendous guilt. So Billy told Elizabeth he was going to admit it to John. Well, Elizabeth says, if you tell John, I'm leaving everyone. He was extremely upset.
Not only was Billy's love life in turmoil, but the prospect of finding success with Attila was rapidly dwindling.
I think we had one gig at some club in Greenwich Village. Everybody ran out of the place because the music was so loud.
It was a painful record, and it didn't go anywhere, obviously.
The cocky young musician who just a year earlier had proclaimed he was destined for Columbia Records now found his life falling apart.
Attila died. John and he were no longer working together, and he had nothing to do. He was writing songs, but they weren't for anything in particular. Eventually, Elizabeth kind of threw him out, and this was his infamous living in the laundromat scenario, where he would camp out in the 24-hour laundromat and sleep there. He tried landscaping, which sucked. He hated landscaping. He tried oyster shucking, and, you know, the guys on the oyster boats were saying, watch out for your hand, piano player.
At the time, I was going through this age, which is a difficult age. I was a musician. I wasn't doing very well. Who needs another failed musician? What am I going to do with my life?
He was extremely depressed. I asked Billy to come stay at my apartment. One day, I'll never forget, I wake up, and I don't see Billy. He usually slept on the couch. There was nobody there. And I go into the dining room area, and there's a sheet of paper with what looks like a poem or lyrics to a song. And the song was called Tomorrow Is Today. I didn't even realize for sure it was a suicide note until I got a call from somebody to say Billy was in the hospital.
I got real down. I took myself a little too seriously. I said, I'm going to kill myself. And then there was a bleach, and then there was furniture polish. And, well, which one's going to taste better? I was really thinking like this.
go into the hospital, and there I see Billy walking around, and I'll never forget him coming over to me and saying, "Hey, Irwin, you gotta get me out of here. These people are crazy." And it took me a few more days to figure out how to lie, cheat, and steal and get him released without it being under a doctor's direct care.
Mazur, a dental school dropout, decided to don his retired lab coat, go to the hospital, and pose as a doctor authorizing Billy's release.
You know, I knew some technical terms. I'm sure it'd be a lot more difficult today, but I got him out of the hospital.
Less than a month after Billy hit rock bottom, the tide finally began to turn.
My brother was the art director at Paramount Records. And I'm in my brother's office playing this little piano vocal demo. All of a sudden, guy with long blonde hair sticks his head in the door and says, "What's that playing?" I said, "It's a kid I manage." This fellow who stuck his head in the door, his name was Michael Lang. Michael Lang produced a little music festival called Woodstock. He said, "Well, it's not my kind of music, but could I have a tape? I think I know somebody who might be interested in that."
That somebody was record producer Artie Ripp, the same guy who produced music for successful acts such as the Shangri-Las, the Chantels, and Jay and the Americans.
I knew of Artie because I would see his name in all the music magazines because he had a Buddha and Kama Sutra Records that were huge record companies.
I picked up the phone, called Irwin Mazur, said, "This is Artie Ripp." "Really?" "Yeah, this is Artie Ripp. I love Billy Joel. Let's make a deal."
Anxious to finalize the deal, Billy signed on the dotted line, but he didn't pay much attention to the fine print.
Artie had a very tight contract on Billy, from merchandising to royalties, and he just signed it all away. Every artist does that. They just want to sign that contract and say, "I am a recording artist now."
Billy saw the arrangement with Ripp as a chance to offer financial stability to his on-again, off-again girlfriend, Elizabeth, who was now divorced from Billy's ex-bandmate, John Small.
They took an apartment by Cold Spring Harbor, and he started writing in earnest and, you know, arranging and doing stuff like that.
In early 1972, Artie Ripp put his plan for Billy in motion, flying him to Los Angeles to record what was going to be Billy's breakout album. It seemed as if Billy was finally on his way, until one mistake in the recording studio blew everything apart. In early 1972, Billy Joel was recovering from a suicide attempt, brought on by a failing relationship and a stagnant music career. But then he signed a record deal with Artie Ripp and resurrected a relationship with his girlfriend, Elizabeth. Ripp flew the couple to Los Angeles, where Billy would record his first solo album, Cold Spring Harbor. But there was trouble.
They had gone into the studio and the tape machine ran slow. Cold Spring Harbor was recorded at the wrong speed.
Billy sounded like one of the chipmunks singing it. Okay, and that really sent them over the edge.
There was nothing you could do. The record was out. It's over.
Billy took the album when he played it for the first time off the turntable and flung it against the wall.
Knowing that the chipmunk sound on his record wasn't going to get any radio play, Billy realized he had only one option, to build a fan base one performance at a time.
I was convinced the only way Billy Joel could become a star was that people had to see him in person. The only way I could do it was convincing Artie Ripp at the record company I need what they call deficit tour financing. In other words, give me a checkbook and I'll make Billy a star.
It was now a question of getting him out to go and say, "Hi, I'm Billy Joel, and here's my music."
At the time, Billy was a no-name opening act for more established groups, such as the Doobie Brothers and the Jay Giles Band.
And he really kind of honed his craft of entertaining an audience in a club.
We went from New York to L.A. to Texas to, I mean, God knows what. We even did just Billy alone on piano for the press in all the countries in Europe. Nobody ever heard of Billy. And he became the talk of Europe.
Another important stop was at Philadelphia radio station WMMR, where he recorded a live session, which included a song he had written while on the road.
Captain Jack became WMMR's top requested song. And Clive Davis from Columbia Records heard that song and liked it.
Clive Davis, who discovered so many wonderful acts, Bruce Springsteen, he was instrumental in Bob Dylan, Janis Joplin.
Billy had no idea that the world's premier rock label was interested in him. All he knew was his tour was over, his album wasn't selling, and he was left paying the bills by working in a piano lounge in Los Angeles.
I get a call from a fellow named Kip Cohen. Kip Cohen was the head of A&R for Columbia Records. Says to me, Clive Davis wants to sign Billy Joel. I meet him at the Beverly Hills Hotel. Clive proceeds to tell me that he believes Billy Joel is a superstar. I said, you're right. There's one problem. What's the problem? We're gonna have to make a deal with Artie Ripp. I mean, Artie spent upwards of $250,000 or $350,000. And in those days, that was real money.
Columbia offered Ripp a lucrative return on his initial investment in Billy.
Artie Ripp ended up with 25 cents of every dollar that Billy Joel made from the sale of his records and from his compositions for 10 albums.
Billy was unhappy over the way the deal went down. And though they would remain friends, Billy saw Irwin Mazur's lack of experience as a handicap and fired him as his manager.
I was told that I compromised Billy's position, that I sold Billy's confidence out to Artie.
Sing us a song, you're the piano man. Sing us a song.
Billy and his music were now in the hands of one of the world's most prestigious record labels, and the world was about to meet the Piano Man.
Piano Man, of course, was written about his time in L.A. as Bill Martin. Under a pseudonym, he worked in a piano bar from like 9 p.m. to 2 a.m., just playing, drinking, being around people who drank, and he wrote Piano Man based on those experiences.
It's pretty much the way I put it down in the song. Because I knew when I was working, I said, I gotta get a song out of this.
The song peaked at number 25 on the U.S. Billboard charts. It looked like he finally made it. But for Billy, there was still something missing.
Piano Man is recorded with some of the best studio musicians in L.A. But he is not happy with that. You know, he's worked all his life with bands. And now he's like the solo artist with studio guys, and it doesn't feel the same.
Billy, he had no choice over the producer. But that's the way it was back in the early 70s and before at Columbia Records. You were assigned a producer and you went in a major record.
His earlier producers had basically been focusing on him as a piano player. They were making singer-songwriter records, and they would use studio musicians, and the results were often uneven.
For Billy, that was cause to go rogue and take radical steps to control his next album's sound, even if it meant disregarding the direction of one of the world's most powerful record labels. By 1975, Billy Joel was 26 years old and eager to make some changes in his life. He and Elizabeth had recently married and moved from Los Angeles back to New York. Dissatisfied with the recording studio sound of his last two albums, Billy appealed to Columbia management to help him capture the same rock the house sound he generated in concert. Columbia thought they knew exactly what he needed.
On paper, it looked like a winning combination. You had Jimmy Gershio, famous producer, manager of Chicago, and his ideas to bring in the Elton John band. Sounds like a great idea. It sort of very quickly, Billy realized that the sessions with Jimmy Gershio, they weren't clicking. You know, it just wasn't the sound that he was after. So what does Billy do? He decides, I'm gonna put my wife in as the manager.
She had gone to UCLA and she'd majored in management. So one day Billy said, you should manage me. And the next morning she was managing him.
It wasn't Billy's only radical change.
He decides, I'm gonna produce the album myself with a bunch of musicians that you haven't heard of. In so doing, Billy appeared to be this unmanageable artist.
Determined to do things his way, Billy reached out to some rockers he knew from his days playing in Long Island's local music scene.
Richie Cannata, Doug Stegmeyer, Liberty DeVito, Russell Javers, and he puts together the classic Billy Joel band.
They were all from Long Island, so they had this turf, like a gang, this camaraderie of a place, you know, and the times, and that worked for Billy. It made him feel comfortable.
The album, Turnstiles, captured Billy's return to his roots on the East Coast through songs like Say Goodbye to Hollywood and New York State of Mind.
I'm in New York State of Mind.
We went out that year and did 108 dates from coast to coast, sold most of them out, and we culminated the tour at Carnegie Hall. And here was this guy who was certainly no means a superstar. And I remember the lines around the block to buy tickets. And what I felt happen is we were building the base.
And then it was time to think about the next album. And Billy knew at that point that he had exhausted all of his talents, it seemed at the time, as a producer, and they wanted somebody special.
Elizabeth had a gut feeling about respected producer Phil Ramone, who had worked with the likes of the Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, and Paul Simon.
I got a call and they said, Billy would love to meet you. So we went to this little Italian restaurant across from Carnegie. And I said, I'd been listening to his records and I thought the missing element was the energy that came off that stage and the way his band played with him. And that must have hit a key that he liked, because within the week I got a call and said, Billy would like to work with him.
They captured lightning in a bottle.
With Phil Ramone in the picture, Billy truly hits his stride with the recording of The Stranger, Just the Way You Are, Moving Out, Always a Woman to Me. This album, The Stranger, becomes the ultimate Billy Joel breakthrough album.
Over the next few years, Billy and his new team pumped out hit after hit. He won Grammy Awards and played to sold-out crowds. But the demands of that success took a toll on his marriage.
The work suddenly is your mistress. It's everything about what you think about, day and night.
With Billy as the musician and Elizabeth as his manager, their marriage had become more like a business arrangement.
Elizabeth had so many tasks. She decided, well, who can I trust to take some of the work off of my shoulders? Oh, my brother. I'll bring my brother Frank Weber in.
It's almost like her destiny with him was to help him take his career to a certain level and then leave.
As disappointing as that was, as sad as that was, you know, that's what happened. And so suddenly they're getting a divorce and Billy's going in to make another record.
But the recording session for that record, titled The Nylon Curtain, would be unexpectedly and dramatically interrupted.
He was motorcycling out on Long Island one day, and he went through a green light. Unfortunately, the person coming on a perpendicular path with her automobile had a red light, and she went through it. And she smashed into Billy and was afraid she'd killed him. He had to be medevaced to a hospital in Manhattan. And at first they had to stabilize his life. Then they realized that they might lose his hand.
It was a question of whether he would be able to play the piano again.
Luckily, surgeons were able to reset Billy's bones with five pins. Then, months of physical therapy.
It was a time where I think he really took stock in his life and what was going on.
He is a piano man. He does express himself through the piano. That's what he's all about.
And when he left the hospital with this little thumb that, you know, sort of wiggles around, there was still some question as to whether he could play. Luckily, with a little medical tape, he's able to tape it up and play.
The real test came when Billy returned to the studio to finish recording The Nylon Curtain. His rebuilt hand proved worthy of the challenge, and the piano man was back. On the heels of grueling work on his album and the upheaval of the accident and his divorce, Billy booked a vacation in the Caribbean. He had no idea at the time, though, that his island getaway would provide much, much more than a little R&R. In 1982, Billy Joel was recovering from physical and emotional scars. He had just bounced back from a career-threatening hand injury caused in a motorcycle accident, while at the same time going through a divorce from his wife, who had also been his business manager. Billy decided it was time to get away.
He's down in St. Barts, exactly at the time that Sports Illustrated were filming their swimsuit issue.
He was playing piano, hanging out at the bar, and Al McPherson, Christie Brinkley were all there. I think he wooed Christie with his song.
He and Christie hit it off because they were both kind of wounded. Christie's boyfriend, who was an auto racer, and he died in a car crash on the track, and she was just devastated by that. And they both found each other.
With Christie as his inspiration, Billy released An Innocent Man in 1983.
This was one of the first times Billy was writing songs as a happy guy.
The single Uptown Girl received a Grammy nomination for Best Pop Vocal.
At that point in my life, I mean, I was kind of rediscovering romance. That's how I feel. I feel like a teenager again.
On March 23rd, 1985, Billy and Christie tied the knot on board a ship in New York Harbor. 9 months later, on December 29th, Christie gave birth to their daughter, Alexa Ray Joel. For the first year of their marriage, little was heard from Billy Joel. Fans had no idea he was as focused as ever on making an even bigger musical impact. A series of concerts in the Soviet Union.
He went over in 1987 after a lot of negotiation.
Billy financed the shows himself. He even added a film crew to document the events.
He was at a Moscow arena. They were filming it, and they put the lights out onto the audience.
He got mad at the lighting guy, and he took his electric piano and tossed it off the stage.
People in an audience like to be in the dark. They want to be in the dark. They want to do their own thing. They want to get loose. They want to feel great.
The famous throwing the piano. The way the story was reported, it almost seemed like Billy had picked up a grand piano, walked to the edge of the stage, and hurled it in some sort of political faux pas. It wasn't the case at all.
See, it ain't that bad. A lot of people thought it was a grand piano that I threw. That would have been a tantrum.
In the end, Billy's famously flung piano just drew more attention to the fact that he'd made history as the first Cold War-era American pop star to appear behind the Iron Curtain.
The Russian trip was a statement that, wait a second, we are all the same, and music is an international language, and maybe it's our only hope. And I think that's what that venture ultimately proved.
Billy Joel was a global phenomenon, but he was in for a rude awakening back home.
Christie decides they need a bigger place. She'd like a house out in the Hamptons, doesn't want to live in the city and raise a child in the city. So Billy and Christie find a lovely mansion, and he makes a comment to Walter Yetnikoff one day, his record company president. He said, Walter, I need to sell my apartment in New York to come up with enough money for this mortgage. And Walter Yetnikoff said, do you know how much money you've made? What do you mean you have to sell your apartment?
Billy hired a law firm to examine his books.
Billy does an accounting and realizes $90 million is gone. And Frank is the culprit.
Frank Weber, ex-brother-in-law, godfather to Billy's daughter, and business manager, had kept Billy in the dark about his finances.
Properties and horses and oil futures. He started giving contracts to friends rather than the most competent people. Here's Billy Joel, who's had all of these hit records. I mean, he's done very well, but he's pretty bad off. He's in the hole, actually.
Billy found out he owed the IRS $5.5 million, with an overall debt estimated at around $30 million. He immediately fired Frank and filed suit against him for $90 million for compensation and punitive damages. The courts awarded Billy a $2 million judgment, but Weber was bankrupt, and Billy was unable to collect the settlement. The rock star had only one way to fight back from financial ruin.
At that time, Billy had to become a road warrior. He lost his fortune, so he went out there to remake his fortune, to put his financial life back.
In 1989, he released Stormfront and went on a worldwide tour that would put him in front of an estimated 3.5 million people.
Doing four nights in Des Moines, you know, four nights in Minneapolis.
You know, I've been doing this damn thing all over the world, right?
We were doing stupid business.
The two-year tour culminated in Mexico City, grossing roughly $65 million. Billy's financial woes were behind him. With his own affairs in order, Billy began directing his attention toward others in need, especially the baymen of Long Island, whose traditional seafaring way of life was at risk because of new laws limiting their fishing rights.
They say these waters are in what they used to be. But I got people back online who count on me, so
I grew up on Long Island, and I thought it was a Long Islander's birthright to do that, and as it turns out, it's not anymore, and there's something wrong with that.
Billy's activism was added to an already overstuffed schedule, and the burden of his workload exacted a heavy toll.
He was always working, you know, he was always on the road, and I think that that put a strain on the relationship.
He would be gone for months at a time. You know, when they were on the road, they were seriously on the road. They might come back for a week or two, and then they would go back out.
It would drive any two people apart, which was hard and devastating to a great extent for Billy that that didn't work.
Though they would remain friends, in 1994, Billy and Christy divorced. Billy was once again alone, but he was about to rekindle an old romance, not with a former flame, but rather with a genre of music radically different from the rock and roll that had earned him fame and fortune. By the early 1990s, Billy Joel had bounced back from financial ruin by releasing top-selling albums and touring throughout the world. And though his second marriage had ended in 1994, his career as a rock legend proved to have staying power when in 1999, he was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Billy had officially made his mark in rock history. But there was another musical frontier to explore, which grew more and more important to him as he got older.
Classical music was always the nice, sunny girl from next door, and rock and roll was this girl who smoked cigarettes and torn fishnet stockings with smeared mascara who dragged me away and seduced me. And we had a wild flaming affair for 35 years, 40 years. And all of a sudden I rediscovered the girl next door and said, oh, she's not bad.
Billy's first exposure to classical music had been through his father.
Billy once said that the only time he ever got beaten as a kid was when his father caught him improvising on a Beethoven sonata. So his father was very strict about classical music. He wasn't a big pop fan.
It's no secret, Billy said it many times, I don't think Howard Joel liked pop music.
By the year 2000, Billy Joel had longed to become a classical composer. In the meantime, he reunited with his long-lost father and became acquainted with his half-brother, Alexander, a classical musician in Vienna, Austria. He came upon the idea of doing a symphonic album called Fantasies and Delusions, and really enlisted his half-brother.
Through Fantasies and Delusions, I think that was a way for Howard, for Alex, and for Billy to sort of connect and transcend time, certainly transcend lost time, and forge a very important connection.
Though the album debuted at number one on the classical chart, its sales paled in comparison to his rock albums. But the music had been a labor of love, which was a lifetime in the making. And for Billy, there was also a new romance in his life.
Katie Lee Joel was someone who had aspirations for television and in fact was the first hostess for Top Chef, the TV show.
Billy had met Katie Lee one night while out on the town in Manhattan, and the two were instantly drawn to each other.
At the age of 55, suddenly announced he was marrying a 22-year-old.
In 2004, the two wed in a lavish ceremony at Billy's Oyster Bay estate, with Billy's half-brother Alexander as the best man, and his daughter Alexa Ray as the maid of honor. Then, later that year,
he had a car accident where he ran his car into a house.
It was Billy's third car crash in just 2 years. Police reports indicate the accidents were not alcohol-related. Still, drinking had been a problem for Billy, and he checked himself into the Betty Ford Clinic. Not long after, Billy and Katie's lives began to grow in separate directions.
When you have that kind of age discrepancy sometimes, you have different agendas. I don't think it was just age. I think it was also just sometimes personality. They just grew in different places.
It was his third divorce. Once again single, Billy found time to go back on the road for his hugely successful face-to-face tours with fellow rock legend Elton John.
He's very funny. He can make me laugh. He's got a very dry sense of humor, and he makes the audience laugh.
In the midst of his successful tour with Elton John, Billy was invited to play a concert commemorating the closing of Shea Stadium. The first rock concert ever held there was the Beatles in 1965, a concert Billy saw as a child, and a band that shaped Billy's lifetime of music. He wanted his show to be a fitting tribute, so he gathered top recording artists including Garth Brooks, Tony Bennett, and Paul McCartney.
Billy finishes the show, as he finishes most of his shows these days, with Piano Man. Following Piano Man, Billy asked Paul, you should close it. For a Beatle to close, who had really opened the building, for a Beatle, on Billy Joel's stage, to close Shea Stadium with Let It Be. It was a magic moment.
In 2010, the concert became the focus of a documentary film called The Last Play at Shea.
One thing that he's done that very few musicians do is that he's spoken to a number of generations over the years. If you're an older fan, you'll remember Piano Man.
Sing us a song, you're the piano man.
If you're an 80s kid, you'll remember Tell Her About It or Uptown Girl. If you're a later 80s kid, what you're going to remember is We Didn't Start the Fire. So he's written standards for all of these different sorts of generations. Good luck getting those songs out of your head. It's just not gonna happen. They're very memorable. And most of those songs haven't left the radio.
Let's be remembered for being a good writer. That's the most fulfilling part of the gig. And the most creative part for me is the moment of creation. And it would be nice to be remembered for having written music that reflected my time.